Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now we're glad to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. We welcome any visitor that might be visiting with us. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now this is Preacher Edward speaking. And if you get on the phone and call a friend, have them to tune in and get this hour, we appreciate it. And if you'll call someone to have them to tune in and get the message out in the radio listening audience, we appreciate it so very much. If you're not getting our daily broadcast, if you'll tune into the station where you're now listening, you can get the daily broadcast Monday through Saturday at 12 o'clock noon. I'd appreciate it if you do so. I'd appreciate it if you tell others about it. Now, I'm speaking today on this subject, Where's the Beef? This is tape number 127. Someone said the woman that asked that question on the commercial said she choked to death on the bun. I don't know how true that is. I guess maybe that's just a rumor. But we want to find out where the beef is today. So you turn to Luke chapter 15 for the reading of God's word. Luke chapter 15. Where is the beef? I think we can find as far as God's children are concerned from the Bible. And turn to Luke 15. While you're turning there, let me give you my mailing address. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. I'd most certainly appreciate you writing to me. Now, the preacher has a birthday coming up 1 week from tomorrow, if God spares my life until that time. My birthday is on May the 28th. And a wonderful gesture that would be encouraging to me in regard to my birthday would be for you to write to me and let me know that you appreciate our ministry and that you're praying for our ministry and that you're willing to stand by as God might provide for you to do so financially to help get out the word of God during the closing days of this grace age. These milestones, they really fly by when you get over the hill, start down on the other side. Seem like they come about every month instead of every year. But I appreciate every year that God has allowed me to remain on planet Earth. And one of these days that'll come to an end, either at the rapture or at death. We realize that, but we praise God for every year that God permits us to remain on planet Earth and preach the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Greatest honor I've bestowed upon any man is a call into the gospel ministry. It's far greater to be a God-called, God-anointed preacher than it is to be the president of a nation. Now you remember that. That might help you as you sojourn for God, you young people. God may speak to your heart about being used of Him. God wants to use you. God will use you if you let Him. There's many honorable professions in the world today, but the greatest of these is in the ministry of getting out the gospel, because that's lasting. You may have a profession on this earth, and when you come to die, it's over. But if you give your life into the service of God, God keeps a record in heaven, and there comes a rewarding time on the other side. And if God speaks to you as a young person about your life's future, about what you should be doing in the future, and God speaks to you about serving Him, it'd be one of the greatest honors ever bestowed upon you, and you need to remember that. And God may speak to some of you. Unless God speaks to you and leads you into the ministry, or as a missionary, or as a full-time Christian worker, unless God directs you in that direction, then you serve God wherever you may be serving, that is, in your capacity, wherever you might be sojourning for God, whether it be in politics, in some other kind of profession. You serve God and do your best. God will bless you for it. Now, Luke chapter 15, beginning with verse 11, and he said, a certain man had two sons. And the young of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. He divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my fathers have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. Now I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, Bring forth the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. By this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now if you want to know where the beef is, it's found in verse 23. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. Now number one, why this young man left the beef? Now he was dwelling in the father's house where they had the steak, the fatted calf, the beef, if you please. They could have the steak, the beef stew, and whatnot in the father's house, roasted beef and so forth. But here is a young man that decided he would leave the beef and go away. The Bible says in verse 12 that he was a selfish man. The younger said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And his father divided unto them his living. Here's a young man that's downright selfish. Now in the Christian realm today, there's no room for selfishness. When you're living for self and selfish, you're not honoring God. Now this man was selfish. Secondly, he wanted to get away from the restraints of his father. Now many times you have young people today that feel the same way. They want to get away from the restraints of their parents, get out somewhere where they can be more or less on their own. And there's many of a young teenager today out in the world that's fallen into sin, that's out among the wicked and the drug addicts and the drunkards, the harlots and the whoremongers, the prostitutes and whatnot, because they left their home and they went out among the riotous living people. You need to keep your children at home and keep them with you as much as you possibly can. You need to keep them in the house of God as long as you can. You need to keep them in a good, fundamental, Bible-believing church where they can hear the Word of God. I've known of parents to let their children go out into other denominations, other movements, in order that they might be with the young people. And then later they followed them until they finally lost their children and lost their own testimony. Now, you don't maintain your testimony and don't stay in the right direction following your children. Your children are supposed to follow you. Now, God doesn't lead in that direction. God never leads a young person or adult away from a fundamental Bible-believing church to go into a church that supports modernism, that's worldly, that caters to worldliness. Now, had this father here said, Well, my son is leaving home. He's leaving the beef, so I'm going to follow him and let him go down in the world and sweetheart and have a good time out in the world, because he deserves to be with the young people. They don't have many young people around our house, no doubt, he would say, but I'll just go with my boy where they have a lot of young people and have a good time, because he's young and he deserves that. And I've had that father followed that boy, or that mother followed that boy, then they would have completely lost the boy and lost their own testimony. But the father stayed where the beef was. The young boy left the beef and the father stayed there and prayed and waited for his boy to come back home, and finally he came back. Now you parents, stay put, stand by your guns. Don't allow yourself to be led away or pulled away or persuaded away by worldly pleasures and the things of this world. If your young people, if your children wander out, leave your home, go somewhere else, go to another church, go to another town, then you stay put for God. Don't compromise, and you can eventually win them back into the Father's house where the beef is if you'll stay put and don't compromise. The Bible says in verse 13, not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into far country. Now he wanted to go out and have a fling with the world. He wanted to go where they're having a good time. They were dancing and making music where he was going, and he was having, it could have a good time away from the Father's house. The Father couldn't tell him what to do and what not to do because he wouldn't be there. His mother didn't have no influence over him either because she couldn't speak to him. And so he wanted to leave, and he left the beef. Number two, let's notice why he seemed to forget about the beef. Now, seemingly he forgot all about the fatted calf in the Father's house. The Bible says he traveled far away, verse 13, and he took his journey into a far country. This boy went a long way from home. And many times when young people begin to drift, they just keep on drifting and drifting and drifting. And you'd be surprised today to know how many teenagers, even from 10 years old on up to their 20s, that's out here in the world, falling in the hands of criminals, used for prostitutes and dope addicts and the peddle dope and whatnot, that left their home and just kept on drifting and drifting. And many of them are murdered every year, and their parents know not where they are, whether they're dead or alive. When these wicked, ungodly criminals that the appeal courts have turned loose, ACLU have turned loose upon the world, then when they get a hold of the young people, then they ruin them, and then they put them to death and dispose of their bodies, and their poor parents never hear from them again. They're fallen into the hands of the wicked. And that's sad. This young man took a far journey, and he spent his money freely. He had some money, and he had some beef back home. But here he took his money, and he spent it freely. He had a lot of friends, a lot of buddies, and they liked him because he had money to spend. I've said this many times, if you're not careful, you'll find you have a lot of young friends if you have a nice automobile and a good income. But you lose your car, lose your job, lose your income, you'll find out you don't have so many friends after all. They're just your friend whenever you can do something for them. A friend indeed is a friend in time of need. Now this man was living a fast and righteous life. Number three, notice the bad situation he ended up in. The Bible says in verse 14, he had spent all. He became broke and destitute. Many of a young person have strayed away from home, strayed away from their home church, and became destitute, became broken without money and without friends, and sometimes in ill health. But it took that to bring this boy back home. He spent all, verse 14, and when he spent all, everything seemed to go wrong. As the old saying is, when it rains, it pours, and many times trouble comes in bunches like bananas, and seems like everything goes wrong whenever you're down and out. Now it seems like it happens like that. And there came a mighty famine. Verse 14, there arose a mighty famine in the land. He is far away from home. He has spent all of his money. He had no income. No doubt his clothes is worn thin, maybe barefooted, and they're hungry. And the Bible said he began to be in want in verse 14. And so he was in want. Now he would have never thought about the beef and said, where is the beef, unless he had begun to be in want. And the Bible said here in the fourth place, verse 14, he was sent to feed swine. Now that was abomination in the eyes of any Jewish lad or Jewish family. And yet he was sent to feed swine. In verse 14, he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him in his fields to feed swine. Now this young man had to go do a job in order to survive. That was abomination to him, an abomination in sight of God, and a shame and humiliating to his family if they knew about it. A Jew feeding hogs. Now that hog was condemned in the eyes of that Jew, and they despised and hated a swine. And so he was sent to feed swine. Occasionally I cut on the TV, and I don't do it on purpose, but occasionally, maybe on Saturday afternoon, I maybe try to get the news or something and happen to hit one of these old hard rock bands on there. And you never saw the like in your life at people, the way they dress, the way they act, the way they jump and act like a bunch of crazy idiots and act a fool and jump up and down. And you never saw the like. They have to be demon possessed, and they have to be on dope or alcohol to be that crazy. They couldn't be that stupid unless they're on dope or really carried away by demonism. And young people have strayed away from their homes. Their parents let them do so and get involved in a terrible crowd like that. And then they show that stuff on TV and get young people out in their homes involved looking at that crazy junk that drive you up the wall if you have good sense. Now, beloved, listen to me. That's what the world has to offer. Now, what made this young man think about the beef back home? The Bible says he ate the food that the hogs ate. Verse 16, he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. Here is a man that had to eat the husk that the swine ate. Now, they had the husk, the swine food, the locusts on the trees. And there he would pull them off and feed the hogs. He ate that stuff. And they had nothing else to eat. Now, he had some beef back at the father's house. And he's beginning to wonder, now, where's the beef? Well, the beef was back in the father's house. No one could help him, verse 16, and no one gave unto him. Now, when you get down and out and need help, you find out who your true friend is. Now, you have a lot of friends as long as you can do something for them. But when you get in need, you'll find out your true friend. And so no man gave unto him, and he came to himself in verse 17. And the Bible said when he came to himself. Now, why did he come to himself? He was on starvation. His clothes worn out. He was barefooted. He was suffering. He had no money. And then he came to himself when he began to think about the beef back in the father's house. He said, my father hath bread enough to spare back there, that he has meat in his house. And I'm a fool down here. Now, what did he do about it? We find, according to verses 18 and 19, he planned on something to do about it. He planned on what to do. Verse 18 and 19, I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. So he figured up a little spiel in his own mind that he would spill out to his father when he went back home. And he thought about the beef. He said, now the beef is back there. The bread's in my father's house, and I'm starving to death. I'll arise and go to my father. And in verse 20, he arose and came to his father. Where was the beef? The beef was in the father's house. And he knew that. He knew where it was. And he said, I'm going back to my father's house. That's where the beef is. Now the Bible plainly tells us that Jesus said, strong meat belonging to them that are full age. Now, Paul, of course, said that in Hebrews 5:14. Jesus, on one occasion in John chapter 21 and verse 5, when he went out to the sea there while they were fishing, the Sea of Galilee, Jesus said, children, do you have any meat? Do you have any meat? The answer is no, they had no meat. Now, why did they not have any meat? They left the place where the beef was and went out fishing. Now they served God till they crucified the Son of God. And they said, well, the Lord has been crucified now. We might as well go back fishing. Simon Peter said, I go fishing. The other disciples said, we'll go with you. And a number of them went back, and the Bible said they toiled all night and caught nothing. Why could they catch anything? Why couldn't they catch some fish that night? Well, they had left the Lord, that's why. They had gone back on God. They had disobeyed the Lord. They had left the ministry and gone back to the old trade, back there fishing. And so they worked all night long, sailing in that cold water of the Sea of Galilee and caught nothing. They caught nothing because they were disobedient. They had failed God. They had left the work of God. And so Jesus came on the scene and said, children, have you any meat? The answer was no. You don't get any beef out there in disobedience to God. If you get the beef, then you must get it in obeying God. You don't get it out in the world, out of fellowship with God. The beef is in the Father's house. The fatted calf is where the Father is. The fatted calf is where you fellowship with the Father. and enjoy the things of God. In Psalms 145 and verse 15, the psalmist said that thou gavest them meat in due season. In Proverbs chapter 31 and verse 15, speaking about this great virtuous woman, the Bible said she gave meat to her household. Here's a woman provided beef for her house. She gave meat for the household. She knew where the beef was, and she gathered it together for her household. The Bible says in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10, talking to Jewish people back in those days when they brought the food from the land into the storehouse and stored that food in the storehouse to take care of God's servants and take care of the people and so forth. The Bible says in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10, to bring your tithes into the storehouse so it be meat in my house. And when those Israelites brought the tithes into the store building where they stored the food, then there was meat in there. And when people were in need, they had meat to take care of the people. That's why the beef was. They had it there in the storehouse. And today, as you support the work of God and bring of your tithes and offerings into God's house and give of your means, you're providing beef for God's people. Meat for God's people, spiritual meat I'm talking about. The true gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And he said, there'd be meat in my house. Now, what did this man do about it? He said, I'll rise and go to my father. And he arose and came to his father. He said, I'm a fool down here at the hog pen. Listen, these hogs grunt and they stink and I eat the same slop that they eat and I'm foolish. And he said, the beef is back in my father's house. If someone had come to him and said, listen, son, where's the beef? He'd said, well, it's back where I left it in the father's house. There's a lot of backslidden church members out there in the radio listening audience right now that's listening to me. They got their names on the church roll. Some of them got their names on this church roll. Some of them have their names on other church rolls. They're sitting there starved to death spiritually, grumbling and griping and complaining. And everything is going wrong because they left the place where the beef is. Now, if you ought to get back in fellowship with God and do right and have the blessings of God, then find out where the beef is. You don't have to sit out there in the radio listed audience and grumble and groan and complain. And a lot of people, every time you see them, they're just so down and out and having physical problems and everything is going wrong. They never think and realize if they'd get right and get in tune with God and go where the beef is, many times those problems could be corrected. But they won't do it. They're stubborn, they're hard-headed, they're grunt and groan and carry on and talk about this, complain about that, and they have left the place where the beef is. Now, in order to be strong and healthy in the Lord and have God's blessings, you're going to have to find out where the beef is. And when you find out where the beef is, get in there and get you a potion, and you'll be strong in the Lord. Every born-again believer that loves God's in a true Bible-believing fundamental church, eating the beef of God, he's strong. He's not blown about by every wind of doctrine. He stays put. He's got his feet on the ground, his head in heaven, as it were, and he's serving the Lord. Now, this man here decided to come back to the father's house where the beef was. Now, let's find out what the father did about it. The father did five things when he saw this boy coming back where the beef was. Notice number one. The Bible said when he was a great way off, his father saw him. Verse 20, that meant his father was looking for him. His father never given him up. His father knew he had some beef there, and that boy would come back one day where the beef was. And he saw him coming a great way off. Secondly, he had compassion on him in verse 20. The father didn't run out and cuss him out and beat him up and try to run him off again. The Bible said he had compassion on him. Number three, he ran to meet him in verse 20. The only place in the Bible you ever find where God ever got in a hurry, and that's in a type only when he's running to meet this boy coming home, which is typical of a lost sinner. And then in verse 20, he hugged his neck. He didn't go out there and say, now listen, boy, you're awful ragged looking. You stink like a hog pen to me. It's good enough for you, and I'm glad you got in that predicament. No, no. The Bible said he hugged his neck in verse 20. Put his arms around him. Number five, he kissed him in verse 20. And so this father here did five things, and five is a number of grace extended from the father toward the son. The son had realized where to find the beef. Where's the beef? It's in the father's house. You find the beef in a good, true, fundamental, Bible-believing church where the word of God is preached. That's why you find your beef. You find your beef in the Word of God in the prayer rooms. You find your beef as you serve God faithfully. You find it in the true church. Where's the beef? It's in the Father's house. Number 7, what the Father commanded to be done for him. Now when the Father received him back, he didn't say, "Now boy, I got to go on about my business and you make yourself at home and get along the best way you can." He didn't say that. The Father commanded that 4 things be done for this boy. Number 1, he says in verse 22, to bring forth the best robe and put it on him. Now this boy had on a terrible, stinking, ragged outfit he'd worn down at the hog pen, and probably barefooted and long-haired and dirty. And the Father said, bring that best robe. He didn't say, "Now you go get the old worn-out robe." He didn't say, "Go get the robe he left behind when he went away." The Father said, in the wardrobe, there's a brand new robe there, the best one in there, the most expensive robe in that wardrobe. I want you to bring it and put it on this boy. And so he had this done for him. Notice what the Father commanded to be done for him. First, to bring forth the best robe. Secondly, he said, I want you to put a ring on his finger. Now that ring, of course, spoke of never-ending love. It spoke of being honored by having a ring put on your finger. When Joseph was made prime minister in Egypt, Pharaoh put a ring on his finger and a chain about his neck. That ring there is symbolic of binding love. And the Father said, put a ring on his hand. Not only that, number 3, the Father said, put some shoes on his feet. Now, putting the ring on the hand is symbolic of the hand serving God. It's symbolic of being bound by the love of God. It's symbolic of the never-ending love of God. And then he said, put some shoes on his feet. Now, shoes on his feet, of course, speaks of service and walking for God. And so he had some shoes put on his feet in verse 22. No doubt he was barefooted. Slaves in those days went barefooted. Only members of the household and servants could wear shoes. And he put shoes on his feet, which speaks of service. And then number 4, he said, bring out the beef. And number 4 in verse 23, bring hither the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat and be merry. And at last the boy found out where the beef was. Where's the beef? The beef was here in the Father's house where he'd left it. Some of you out there in the radio listen audience right now, you're not doing well, you're miserable, you're backslidden, and the trouble is you left the beef. You need to get back into God's house where you ought to be in a true church and get to eating on the beef of God and get restored back into fellowship. And they brought forth the beef, and there something happened. The Jubilee was on in verses 24 and 25. And they began to be merry. Now the elder son was in the field, and he came and drew nigh to the house. He heard music and dancing. They had some beautiful music, and they were dancing for joy there in the Father's house. They were having a real jubilee. You know why? The boy remembered to come back where the beef was. When he found out where the beef was, he came back to it. Where was the beef? In the Father's house. And he came back home. Now, Jesus said on one occasion in John chapter 4 and verse 34, Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and finish his work. Now, your meat, your beef is to do the will of God and finish the work that God has called you to do. God has a job for every one of you. That's something each one can do to the glory of God as a true Christian. God wants you to do that. Jesus here had won this woman to himself at Jacob's well. The disciples had gone in the village to buy bread, and they came back and they offered Jesus some bread. And Jesus said, no, I don't want no bread. He said, my bread, my meat is to do the will of my Father and to finish my job. Jesus came to do a job, and he did that job, and he finished that job. Now what you need to do is to stay where the beef is, feed up on God's word, and finish the job that God has called you to do. You'll be glad you did when you come to the end of life's journey. There's a lot of backsliders like this prodigal son out there this morning at home. They ought to be in God's house. They know that. They're backslidden on God. They could be here. Some of them groaning and griping around about not feeling it, but they could be here, and yet they're not here. Why? Because they're backslid on God. Their heart's not right with God, and they fail to get in where the beef is and be strong in the Lord. And if you're not strong in God, you haven't found the beef like you ought to. Where's the beef? The beef is in God's house. Where's the beef? The beef is in God's book here, and you can find it if you want to, and you can be strong in the Lord. Let's stand to our feet. Our Father, I pray that you'll take the message today and use it to thy glory. Help thy people to find out where the beef is, that they might feed upon the wonderful word of God. Lord, we know the devil's deceiving millions and millions today in religion on the road to hell without God. Father, I pray that you speak to hearts here this morning. Get glory to thyself. Thank you, Father, for the beef of your word. Thank you, we know where the beef is this morning, and we want to always feed upon it. Bless thy people. Use this message, and we praise your name for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now listen to me. Debbie's going to play on the organ for a moment or so. If you're in this building and you need to get saved, you ought to come down here and let me help you to God. If you die like you are unsaved, you'll go to hell and be tormented forever, just as certain as you're listening to me. You don't have to go to hell. You can get saved. Some of you starve to death because you've forgotten where the beef is. You need to find out where it is and feed up on the beef of God's word. If there's anybody here who wants to get saved, come back to God, join the church, or however God may be leading you today, obey God as Debbie plays for us at this time. Just walk right down to the front. We'll help you. Many of a poor soul in hell today because it waited too late to get right with God. They're screaming in the regions of the damned. You don't have to go on and die without God. You don't have to live at the hog pen. You can come to the Father's house and enjoy the blessings of God if you're in a backslidden condition. How about it while we wait? We'll help you if you'd like to be helped. God's not going to save any person against his will. God lets you go to hell and burn forever before he saves you against your will. You've got to be willing to repent and accept Christ as your Savior or die without God. God doesn't force his son. He doesn't force salvation on anybody. He just let them go on to hell if they don't want to get saved.